Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. In the last video on this playlist, we focused on the electrons in an atom. We learned that the Bohr model of the atom is unique and valuable because it describes electrons as existing in different energy levels outside of the nucleus. We also discovered a relationship between the number of electrons in an atom and that atom's location on the periodic table. In this episode, we'll focus on the relationship between the properties of an atom and the atom's location on the periodic table. You'll see that the particular period and group an atom belongs to is not only related to how many energy levels and valence electrons it has, but how large or small the atom is and how likely it is to gain or lose electrons. In order to better understand periodic trends, it's helpful to construct Bohr models of the atom. Before we get too far, I want to remind you of a couple of guidelines that are important to follow when making a Bohr model. Although the Bohr model focuses on placement of electrons into different energy levels, it's also important to include the number of protons and neutrons in the nucleus of the atom. The interaction between the electrons and protons determines many atomic properties. Each energy level can hold a maximum number of electrons. This table shows the maximum number of electrons for each energy level. The first energy level, closest to the nucleus, can only hold up to 2 electrons. The second energy level can hold up to 8. The third energy level can hold up to 18 electrons. And the fourth and fifth energy levels can hold up to 32 electrons. Larger atoms with more electrons can exist. But these 5 levels are all you need to understand the naturally occurring elements found on Earth. This Bohr model shows the same information in graphical form, and it's available in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. You might be wondering why we care about periodic trends. Understanding periodic trends helps us to predict the properties of an atom and to determine how it will chemically react with other atoms to produce all sorts of useful compounds like medicines, fertilizers, and cosmetics. Atoms are arranged on the periodic table in such a way that certain properties increase or decrease, moving across a period and down a group. Our goal in this unit is to identify and explain these trends so we can predict the chemical reactivity of elements. Our students will work in teams to make Bohr models of 2 elements in the same group, 1A. Those elements are lithium and sodium. So let's go out to our classroom to learn more about periodic trends.
Okay, let's get started. Anna and Charlie, use your whiteboards to draw the Bohr models of lithium and sodium. And Danica and Karina, let's have you guys use the magnetic models to create the same 2 Bohr models. And we all need to be able to draw the Bohr models, but the magnetic models offer us the advantage of keeping the relative sizes of the atoms correct. And when you're done, we'll compare the electronic structure of lithium and sodium. And as you construct your models, be sure to remember to put the correct number of protons and neutrons in the nucleus so that we can discuss the strength of the attraction between the protons and the electrons.
Let's start with the nucleus. Lithium has 3 protons and sodium has 11.
The first energy level has 2 electrons, so let's put those in both atoms.
Now, lithium only needs 1 more electron, so that goes into the second energy level.
Let's see. Sodium has a total of 11 electrons, so I need to add 9 more to this model.
The second energy level only holds 8 electrons, though.
Okay, so that means that the last electron goes into the third energy level. That's gotta be right because sodium is in group 1A and has 1 valence electron.
Okay, did you finish your Bohr models? Let's have both teams hold up their Bohr models so that we can compare lithium and sodium. Now, what differences do you see?
Sodium's got a lot more electrons. Lithium only has 2 energy levels and sodium has 3.
Is that why lithium is in period 2 on the periodic table and sodium's in period 3?
Yep, good job. Now, what about the nucleus? What's different between the 2 nuclei? Danica?
Lithium only has 3 protons and sodium has 11, kind of like their electrons.
Yes, that's right. And it's important to look at the nucleus because there's a strong attraction between the protons and the electrons. And that attraction is going to affect the atom's properties. Which brings us to the introduction of a new term, effective nuclear charge. It's the net positive charge felt by the valence electrons from the nucleus. And a higher effective nuclear charge means that there's going to be a stronger attraction for the electrons to the nucleus. And so, as you're looking at your models, which element, lithium or sodium, is going to have a stronger attraction between its valence electrons and the protons? And you need to be careful, okay, because there's a lot to consider when answering this question.
Sodium has more protons than lithium. Does that mean that its electrons feel more attraction to the nucleus?
Sodium does have more protons, but there's a little bit more to the story. So let's take a look here at the Bohr model for a sodium atom. And here is our Z sub F, which represents effective nuclear charge. Now, because its valence electron is farther away from the nucleus than lithium's, that valence electron actually feels less attraction to the nucleus. The inner electrons here, which we refer to as core electrons, are going to also repel or shield that interaction from that one valence electron to the positive nucleus, and that's going to make that attraction even weaker.
So the farther away from the nucleus, the weaker the attraction.
Yes. The higher the energy level, the weaker the attraction, or the smaller the effective nuclear charge. But remember, the distance from the nucleus and the shielding by the core electrons, it lessens the effective nuclear charge.
Now that you've been introduced to the idea of effective nuclear charge, this is a good place to introduce three atomic properties that are of interest to chemists: ionization energy, electronegativity, and atomic radius. Soon we'll look for periodic trends for each of these atomic properties. Ionization energy is the energy needed to remove a valence electron from an atom, which often happens in chemical reactions. Ionization energy is an important characteristic of atoms because it helps explain why some atoms lose just one electron when bonding, why some lose two, or even why some atoms don't lose electrons at all. Electronegativity is the ability of an atom to attract additional electrons and is an important property of an atom when making chemical bonds. We'll explore chemical bonds in depth in Unit 4, and you'll see why electronegativity is possibly the most important elemental property that we will study. We can make so many predictions about how elements will interact with each other if we have a good understanding of electronegativity. Atomic radius gives us an idea of the size of an atom and is found by measuring the distance between the nuclei of two touching atoms and then dividing that distance in half. There are some unusual trends in the sizes of the atoms, as we will soon see. With these three properties of an atom in mind, let's go back to our classroom to see how these properties change throughout the periodic table.
Okay, let's look again at our Bohr models of lithium and sodium, and let's see if we can predict how our three atomic properties will differ. Now, we'll discuss the trend of ionization energy, moving down a group on the periodic table first, and then you'll explore in teams the trends of electronegativity and of atomic radius as we go down a group. So let's start by looking up close at our Bohr models of lithium and sodium here while we try to predict their ionization energies. So who would like to predict what happens to the ionization energy as we move from lithium down to sodium on the periodic table?
Does a high ionization energy mean it's hard to remove a valence electron?
That's right. A high ionization energy means that the electrons are held more tightly by the atom, and therefore it's harder to remove that electron.
Sodium's valence electron is in a higher energy level than lithium's, so its electron is further away. Electrons feel less attraction when they're further away, so I think it'll be easier to remove the valence electron from sodium.
Yes, that's right. Electrons that are farther away from the nucleus are going to have a lower ionization energy. And when we talked about effective nuclear charge earlier, remember we discussed two factors. We talked about the distance from the nucleus and the shielding by the core electrons.
I remember. The more energy levels, the more shielding. So sodium has more shielding than lithium.
Yes, good. Very good. Now let's combine these two factors into one conclusion. So how does the distance from the nucleus and the degree of shielding by the core electrons affect the effective nuclear charge and the ionization energies of lithium and sodium?
I'll try. Sodium's valence electron is farther away from the nucleus and shielded by more core electrons than lithium. So sodium has a lower effective nuclear charge and lower ionization energy.
Excellent. So we can conclude that the ionization energy is going to decrease as we go down a group. And we're going to show these trends on the periodic table as we discover them, showing arrows that represent the trend. And we'll put them over here on the left-hand side of the periodic table. And so let's look for patterns that develop as we add more arrows. So now what I'd like you to do is work in teams, and we're going to determine the trends for electronegativity and for atomic radius. All right? So Anna and Charlie, what I'd like you guys to do is take a look at electronegativity. Danica and Karina, I would like you guys to consider atomic radius. And you may have to refer back to these two definitions for those properties. But your objective is to determine whether or not these properties decrease as we move down a group or increase using the periodic table. So use your Bohr models of lithium and sodium, along with what we've learned about effective nuclear charge to help you out. So record your conclusions along with supporting evidence, and then I'll put your results on the monitor and we can share it with the rest of the class once you've finished.
Now's your chance to practice applying your new knowledge. You'll use the Bohr models of lithium and sodium and what you've learned about effective nuclear charge to see if you can predict whether the other two properties we're looking at, electronegativity and atomic radius, increase or decrease when moving from top to bottom down a group on the periodic table. The following questions should help you guide your predictions. What are the definitions of electronegativity and atomic radius? Which has a higher effective nuclear charge, lithium or sodium? Does a higher effective nuclear charge increase or decrease electronegativity? And does a higher effective nuclear charge increase or decrease atomic radius? If you need help answering these questions, review our discussion while determining the trend for ionization energy. The thought process will be the same. We'll explore trends across a period later on. For right now, focus on the vertical trends. We'll see you at the top of the next video on the playlist when you've finished your predictions.